In this video, we're going to talk about why you should be installing exterior insulation on your residential project. I'm Nick Schiffer. I own NS Builders in Boston, Massachusetts. And behind me is Echo Pond, a custom home that we're building for a client of ours. And joining me today is John Deans from 475 Supply. Energy efficiency is one of the first things that we think about when we talk about exterior insulation. Most wall cavities we've dealt with are cavity insulation. So you have a stud wall, insulation in between the studs. But now we're talking about adding this layer of insulation outside of that wall. What's the reasoning behind that?
Yeah, you get a couple of things out of that. So your studs don't have the same insulation value that your insulation does. And so if they're able to touch the cold air outside, they can draw that into the building. So by putting an extended blanket outside of those studs, you get to reduce that. And we call that reducing thermal bridging.
A lot of times you see these cavity insulations increase spacing on the studs to 24 inches. They might even increase the depth of it. So you go from a 2x6 wall, maybe a 2x8 wall. Right. When you look at the mass of the wall, you're getting a lot of insulation, but you're losing it every 16 or 24 inches because of that stud.
Yeah, so your overall insulation value kind of drops, whereas here you're getting the true R value of that exterior insulation.
Besides exterior insulation, there's other parts to energy efficiency that matter, air tightness being one of them. And I think that's really important to note. That's kind of like our first control layer.
Right.
If you think about it, you put a sweater on and if there's no wind, you know, you're warm, right? And that's your cavity insulation.
Yep.
Now, wind comes, blows right through the sweater. So our weather resistant barrier, which is WRB, that's your air, your vapor, and your water control layer.
That's right.
And that's really like that windbreaker that goes on top. But now we're talking about adding almost another sweatshirt on top of that.
But the whole system is gonna be airtight because of that air control layer. So that blanket on the outside is really gonna help with also preventing condensation happening at that air control layer.
So we're using a Rockwool comfort board, which is a semi-rigid insulation, but it's mineral wool. Question comes up, it's like that can't get wet. It can get wet.
It can get
wet. It's hydrophobic. Moisture is going to make its way in. Water is going to make its way in. It's going to drain and it's going to come out the bottom. That whole dew point, which is where that water will condense, is now moved outboard.
Right. It's going to be somewhere in that layer of insulation. And we're okay with that because if it turns to liquid water there, it's fine. It can drain or it can continue sort of moving through the fibers and then we get to our rain screen.
Back to energy efficiency. We are adding a lot more R value, but that's not the only thing to energy efficiency. It's the WRB and the insulation. Now you're continuous insulation, you're reducing thermal bridging, you have that condensation issue on the outside now, and you have a higher R value. When we think about energy efficiency, from a client's perspective, they're saying, well, I want my home to be comfortable. I want it to be nice and cool in the summer. I want it to be nice and warm in the winter. I don't want to stand near my windows and I don't want to feel the draft. It's all about way of living. It's about the comfort of the home. This is more costly from an assembly perspective, but the way I've always described it is I have a 5-gallon bucket here. This is for your HVAC budget. And I got a 5-gallon bucket here and this is for your insulation budget. I just want to take a little bit out of my HVAC and dump it into the insulation.
That's right. Yeah, you can kind of offset some of those costs by scaling down the systems that it takes to heat, cool, and ventilate the home. It's New England. We get power outages in the winter. Homes like this, they can actually take days before they reach a temperature that's dangerous to live inside, even without that heating, just because of how efficient they are.
We are at a different phase on this project where we actually were insulating the outside of this home on the warmest days of the year. Mark, who's a super on this project, actually said once the home was wrapped, inside the home dropped 20 degrees.
Sure, yeah.
And he goes, it just wasn't baking in the sun anymore and the natural shading of the inside really allowed that temperature to drop. We're doing a black cladding on this house. Mm-hmm. One of the biggest comments is like, man, that house is gonna be so hot.
Right.
I guess it would be if you didn't have this layer of insulation.
Right, if that heat could continue penetrating, but it won't because of this continuous insulation.
When we think about a code perspective or future-proofing perspective, it's about building for 10, 15, even 50 years from now. Is this home gonna be considered something that is high performance 50 years from now? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, at 475 too, we talk about the 100-year home. Like, we want these homes to last 100 years, and what that means now is different than what it meant 100 years ago to still have a home standing. All of these systems go to that future proofing. I love that term because We don't really know what's going to happen 50 years down the road, but this house will be ready to handle almost anything you throw at it.
I want to talk specifically about kind of how this system is put together, because there's also another benefit to doing this that is kind of a byproduct of it. But just from a building science perspective, this is a 3-inch mineral wool board. It's a semi-rigid rock wool board. And on top of that is our WRB. We talk about that drying, and I actually alluded to the fact that moisture can make its way out through it.
Right.
Why is that the case?
Yeah, so I mean, you know, membranes have changed a lot. Like these fabrics, these membranes that we're putting on the outside for that weather-resistant barrier, that WRB, that, as you said, is doubling as an air tightness control layer here too. And it's good to know which one is which when you're building. But this product here, Adhero 3000, is great because it's waterproof and it's airtight, but because of the molecular structure of the material in there, it will allow individual water molecules as vapor to move through it. So if it's more moist on the inside and drier on the outside, those water molecules want to move through. But if this gets pounded and soaked with rain, that bulk water is never going to get through, and it's airtight. In the wintertime, generally warmer, moist inside, drier and cooler outside. In the summer, that's typically reversed because we're air conditioning these buildings. So it's going to be drier and cooler inside. So if we have moisture that sort of migrates in during the summertime, it's okay as long as that can kind of move through and dry to the interior.
But we're not pulling that moisture.
We're not pulling it in
right
there.
With the smart membrane on the inside, you can actually eliminate that entirely by moving that dew point outside that wall.
Right.
Those membranes are wonderful when they're built and you don't ever touch it again. Mm-hmm. And the reality is someone renovates the home, you know, a trade comes in and has to add an additional light, mm-hmm. doesn't use a gasketed box, doesn't tape it well, like you have really high level of, mm-hmm. of failure points. By eliminating it, you've eliminated the potential for that failure, and you know that the envelope itself is going to always perform.
Right.
One of the byproducts of adding all this insulation is the sound. I mean, this site is beautiful, and there's a pond down there, and there's nature, and there's things like that, but when you step inside this home, it's really, really quiet.
And all of these products are used very deliberately, and it comes down to the design and the procurement of those materials. You don't want to just sort of willy-nilly go out and sort of buy whatever and make it work, because we see failures when that happens. And so each one of these layers has to be put in deliberately. And I mean, that's part of my job too,
right,
is working with customers to say, okay, we want to have an air control layer here. We want a WRB. Which one should we use? How does it get installed? All of those things are super critical to making these things.
And I will say, you know, a lot of our projects, you see a lot of these details. We talk about these details on video and on social media, and I might come off as a professional at them, but I'm certainly not. I'm not. I understand building science, but it's not my focus. So, as a builder or an architect or even a homeowner watching this, you know, the benefit of what we're talking about today is the collaboration. So a lot of times, in this case, you know, Vincent and his team at If Possible design the wall assembly. They bring it to us. We actually work through that wall assembly in pre-construction, because they're looking to us as, hey, are we doing this cost effectively? Right. Is it constructible?
Right.
And does it really make sense, or are there better ways to do it?
Right.
And oftentimes we kind of get that first opportunity to vet it. And then beyond that, then I'm calling you and saying, John, hey, this is what we're thinking.
Right.
We actually redesigned it with you guys.
Yeah.
And said, hey, and there was this opportunity where it's like, hey, we can accomplish this in a different way.
Right.
Or we suggest this product because of this reason.
Yep.
You know, we talked about failures that we had on other projects, and we addressed those really like direct, said, John, like, we can't have that type of failure again. And not only were you able to kind of work with us on what product, but also like explain sometimes why those, you know, maybe another product failed or whatever the case is. Mm-hmm. But the point here is John's role, any vendor's role, when you're working with products, you know, we're always vetting them and making sure that we fully understand them. And that's done in pre-construction in terms of every project that we're getting into.
I like that you said collaboration. It's always about the team to me, is making sure that everybody's part is played so that we get that continuous whole.
I want to talk about the thing that you're probably staring at here, the rain screen on this home. When we think about costs and labor and what goes into exterior insulation, this is a real factor. So there's a couple things to consider, especially from when we're constructing a home like this. We can add exterior insulation. Sure, that goes up. You put a couple screws in, you're making quick progress.
Yeah.
but you really are complicating the cladding, the roofing, mm-hmm. even the trim. So for here, you know, these are, our projects are unique in nature. So we're not typically dealing with traditional trim detailing and roof overhangs. You know, this is what has been dubbed the Monopoly frame. Right. So there's no overhangs. But what we're looking at is essentially this rain screen that is, you know, labor intensive. There's probably been four guys working on this for a couple weeks now. Mm-hmm. That is a factor that has to be considered in terms of cost.
Sure.
And going into it. Now, what I think is really important is exterior insulation is one of the best things I think that you can do from an energy efficiency standpoint, from an enduring perspective of how to build a home that is long lasting and it's going to meet and exceed code for years to come. But you need to consider this as one of the most important details that you need to think about before you start construction. Because guys will go into this and say, hey, let's add exterior insulation. And then all of a sudden it's like, how do I detail this?
Right.
The details really need to be thought mm-hmm. up front. So I want to walk through kind of what we're looking at. Essentially, we have the exterior insulation and we have 2x4 that are screwed every 16 inches. Before they even started with the insulation, they came down here, they basically marked all of our studs and then took the 2x4s. And really smart idea, but they actually snapped the line dead center of the 2x because you know that 2x is gonna wonk, especially being pressure treated. Now to answer a lot of the questions, pressure treated was just used. It's not that we're concerned with this wood rotting over time. It was just, you know, why not add the extra protection of pressure treated? You know, and it, why I don't think it will rot is because it dries.
It dries, exactly.
There's a 3-inch cavity here, sometimes two, depending on where our strapping lands. That is a full drying cavity. It's vented on the bottom and it's vented at the top. And essentially every 16 inches, they're putting these headlocks in back to the stud. It's really important mm-hmm. to tie these back to structure because that's essentially what's gonna hold all of our cladding on the home. If we were installing horizontal siding mm-hmm. or cladding, mm-hmm. we'd be done.
Yeah, we wouldn't need that horizontal strap.
Yeah, we could just put our clapboard here. We could put whatever the case is. In this case, we're doing shingles. Now, they are a mega shingle. They're about 4 feet by 4 feet. With shingle or any vertical type siding, mm-hmm. you then need to go back and add the horizontal strapping. And the reason you can't do horizontal strapping directly to the insulation is for drainage.
Right.
You want to make sure that water, bulk water, can make its way down below. Now there's products that allow for it. One of them actually being this here. This is our insect guard. Question comes up all the time is critters and insects coming right. up behind it. They're not going to do it. This allows bulk water to come down and air to come down and blow right through and drain out. Like I said, there's other products that you can use that can be installed horizontally that allow that water to drip, but yeah. we needed something that was structural,
yeah.
Which is why you have these 2x4s. Now, if you look closely, you have this one here, which is about 1¾ inches, and then up here, about 1¼ inches, and then here it goes down to 5/8 to 3/4 inch, and that's to set the angle for our mega shingle. So have you seen them?
Yeah,
let's go look.
They're pretty impressive.
So on this project, we're actually doing what we've dubbed the mega shingle, and they're about 4 feet by 4 feet. It's a Roseburg marine grade plywood that we are then coating all 6 sides with a custom mixture, which is essentially a pine tar mixture, essentially a finish that's been used for literally 3,000 years. And then you can see how we have a handful of screws and that goes into that one piece of horizontal. And we have that core vent here that creates that really deep shadow. And then you have your middle rail that you're screwed into and then your top rail up top. And that gives you that shingling effect. It's a really unique detail. And then kudos to Of Possible for kind of pushing us on it.
Yeah.
And then Roseburg for stepping in and working with us to make sure that we're not only using the right quality plywood, but is it gonna be compatible with finish and things like that. That's a sneak peek. We'll do another video on that when we get the entire thing installed. Appreciate you guys watching. See you next time.